Admiral, could you give us some sense for growing up in North Dakota in the 1940s and your appointment to the Naval Academy, how you chose to go to Annapolis and your first experiences having graduated during the war?
Well, I was born in North Dakota, and my father was a minister, and a member of his church was Senator Gerald Nye, the isolationist, and nobody in North Dakota really wanted to go to the Naval Academy. In those days, each senator and congressman had X number of appointments, so when I was 1 year old, as a present, Senator Nye gave to my father a promise for an appointment in 1941, when I would be 16 years of age to get into the Naval Academy, and he honored that. He was still in the Senate then, and I went to the Naval Academy in summer of 1941. I graduated in the early summer of 1944, and went to my first command, my first ship was a battleship, the Battleship Pennsylvania. And I was able and fortunate enough to be involved in the last major surface action in the world, the Battle of Surigao Straits, a night battle, which they demolished the Japanese force coming up the straits through the old crossing of the T operation, which is sort of classic in battleship history. And then I went through various ships and came back working for the Office of Assistant Secretary for Research and Development to be nominated to relieve the prospective commanding officer, Dick Alexander, for the battleship. And I came up here, told Dick we'd not discuss the problems that were involved, and I took over as prospective commanding officer right after Christmas of that year. And we immediately went about trying to get the ship up into shape. I was fortunate enough to have come from 5 years for research and development, so anything that the research and development community had, we stole, took, begged, borrowed, or otherwise commandeered, such as the world's first infrared 5-inch ammunition, which the Navy didn't even know we had. I had 2,000 rounds of that in case we got attacked by a missile. And we had a remote steering device you could sit out on the chair, the quartermaster, and he could twist this dial and it would automatically steer the ship. And we had the world's first surface transit navigational system, and it goes on and on and on. And so we were a mixture of the old and a mixture of the new, and I think the crew enjoyed that part of it.
Sir, as a commanding officer of the world's only battleship going down the Delaware River during your sea trials, what was your thoughts at that time, being the only battleship commanding officer in the world?
Well, I think at that point in time, you don't worry about being the only battleship commander. You worry about, is the ship going to get there safely? Is the ship going to be able to do its job? Did the yard do its job? And is the crew ready to take on? And I think they proved that. Of course, that wasn't the full crew at that particular time. That was just part of the crew, was part of the Philadelphia Naval Shipyard. And we did fire because I wanted to fire to shake a few people up and to find some of the bugs. And all the light fixtures throughout the ship fell down, and all of the vents dumped literally pounds and pounds of soot all over the ship. So the shipyard learned a lesson, which I'd been telling them about, and I'd been very upset with the shipyard workers being so sloppy of leaving their tools around. And they had finally succumbed to my request by putting them all in the after 40 millimeter gun tub mount, which was empty of guns. But so I had the turret captain train over to starboard side directly above the mount, fire the gun, and of course that crushed all the tools. And I think that taught the shipyard a lesson that 16 inches is a little bit bigger than a pop gun.
Slimming down through the Panama Canal and transiting the Indian Canal must have been an experience in itself.
Well, now that was a really tremendous experience because we hadn't sent a ship through there in a long time. That was a large ship, and these ships, of course, were limited in width to the width of the Panama Canal minus a foot and 6 inches. And people building the ships in the various shipyards were competing with each other, so the New Jersey had about 1 inch wider than anybody else and also had 1 or 2 inches longer than anybody else of the four class ships. We had to cut everything off and sort of oil us down because one of the docks had added a water cool fender because of an accident the Japanese freighter had of sparks and burning up. So we're entering this particular one with all the stuff scraped off the side by us when we were at anchor, and all of a sudden you look at the donkey engines that pull the ships through the canal and they begin to jack up and raise up, and they didn't snap any of the cables, but the ship was stuck. It wasn't moving. So the pilot says, what are we going to do? I said, well, you give it to me, back to me, and we'll do something. We got the chief engineer on the phone and guided him through 2 revolutions per minute, which pumped some water out of the dock, and the ship slowly fell into the dock, and that got us through the entrance on that side, and the other side was wide enough. But there's a infamous picture showing all the sailors leaning over and not seeing any water between the ship and the side. We went to the other side of the canal. The pilot took over, and they wiped out all the pilings because the ship has a lot of momentum. And we had a party on the beach. The Panama people did it. Then we went proceeded up to Long Beach, the naval shipyard.
Sir, as you were deploying to the Gulf of Tonkin in September of 1968 on the ship's first war deployment since Korea, what was the crew's mental state at that time? How were they preparing them? How are you as the commanding officer helping the crew get ready for its first combat deployment?
The getting ready for the deployment or actually over there?
Over there and the deployment, sir, yes.
Well, in the deployment, you did everything you possibly could to keep the morale up, and the people of Philadelphia and the Navy League were just absolutely magnificent to keep the morale of the ship up. They had them to parties and everything else, and one character who was a public affairs guy for some studio offered and volunteered to send a whole bunch of, not a bunch, you don't ask, treat people as a bunch, but as many of the young starlets that they could find. And so the crew set up tablecloths in the general mess and candles, and they came over and sat with the crew that day, and that sort of pushed the morale up a little bit. And the newspapers actually helped them because the news media kept them in view as the world's only battleship sailors, and they thought they were better than anybody else, and maybe by the time it was over, they were.
So when you arrived in the Gulf of Tonkin in September of 1968, getting ready for the ship's first gunfire support mission, and then having an opportunity to demonstrate to the world the capabilities of the battleship, explain that or share
that
experience.
I was a little bit upset over that particular one because some public affairs idiot in the Pentagon had decided to put 50 news media on board for the first time the ship had fired, and the first target was, it wasn't the Tonkin Gulf, it was up near the DMZ, I believe, and it was about 45,000 yards, nautical yards, in from where we were 500 yards off the beach. So I went, and of course I couldn't win that when the news media were there, so we went and fired, and the second shot completely destroyed the target, and the Marine pilot flew around and said, well done, we don't have a target anymore.
Is that me? I hope not. I apologize.
Well, that shows you modern technology. Here you are in Vietnam in 1968, popping a 16-inch gun, and there's an electronic buzzer that reminds you of it.
Let's go back and revisit that question again, talking about the ship's first gunfire support mission and the accuracy and the feedback you're getting from the ground, the Marines that you were supporting at that time.
The Marines were so amazed, and because I think people had forgotten that the largest thing they had over there was the Army's 8-inch mortars, or whatever you call them, plus the Navy's 8-inch cruisers. And I remember one time in Norfolk, Virginia, going over to a friend of mine whose name happened to be the same as mine, who was commanding officer of the Newport News, and stealing his dummy 8-inch shell, two of my sailors, and bringing it back to the New Jersey. And when I invited him for dinner, there he comes aboard the starboard side there, the quarterdeck is, and there's a little 5-inch shell like this, and then there's a little 8-inch shell, and then there's this 16-inch shell over here, which is 8 times the size of the 8-inch shell. And I think that taught a few people a lesson. And the Marines learned that over there after that first shot, that when you fire with the New Jersey, whatever the target was is no longer there.
The New Jersey was actually credited at one time for sinking an island. Could you share with us that story?
Well, I'm not sure whether it was Han, Matt, or Tiger. It was the one at the 19th parallel. And we were very close range, which I didn't like to be, but I was requested to be at about 10,000 yards, which is, for this ship, is just absolutely point-blank range. The guns aren't even hardly elevated. Anyhow, there's this big 5-inch thick sliding door where they shot down all of our planes that would come over there in North Vietnam. So my job was to try to get rid of that. And the first shot I fired slightly missed the door and hit the side of the island about 100 yards in. And in slow motion, that part of the island fell into the water. And the New York Times reporter on board reported that back, and the second section of the New York Times had a New Jersey Sinks Island picture, and not picture, but I think it was just a story there, which is sort of a little exaggerated, but it sort of made the crew feel good. And then I guess the crew felt pretty good about the next thing that happened to that same island. After we'd finished obliterating the target, the people that were still alive got in a motorboat and put a white flag up, and I ordered check fire. And then my operations officer says, you can't do that. And I said, well, I'm in the old Navy. I said, John Paul Jones would have checked fire until he got ashore, and we did that. And I was criticized later, but I thought that was the proper thing to do. And that was also the time when, because the president had read that in the New York Times, he called the chairman of the JCS, which I later found, who was then Admiral Moore, who picked up the telephone and called General Abrams, who was running Vietnam. And nobody could get through to me to a message for some reason, which I don't know. So General Abrams got the gunfire circuit, which is unclassified, the spotting circuit, which you probably use. And the quartermaster of the watch comes at me, "Captain, get up to the phone, the TBS right away." He said, "There's some big muckety-muck on the phone, wants to talk to you." So I picked up the phone. He said, "Commander of Battleship New Jersey?" I said, "Yes, this is the captain of New Jersey." So I knew it was an Army guy saying commander instead of captain, and because that's their titles. So he said, "This is Creighton Abrams. Do you know who I am?" I said, "Yes, sir, I know who you are. This is Captain Snyder, the commanding officer of the Battleship New Jersey. What may you want, sir?" He says, "I want to give you a message that I hope you understand. I am holding the chairman on my bell. Do you know what I mean?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "He wants you to head south and get out of there right now. Will you comply? Because I don't have any control over you." He says, "He's sending you a message." I said, "Don't worry, I'm on my way. And Roger, thank you." I hung up the phone, headed back down south. And it turned out that this was where, according to, I learned later, where Secretary Kissinger was negotiating a ceasefire zone in North Vietnam. And according to Senator Warner and the Armed Services Committee, he said that the part of the conditions of the peace treaty in Vietnam was to not send the New Jersey back to Vietnam when our tour was up. So I think that says 1,000 words there.
Yes, sir. The Marines that used to come on board to discuss their experiences having been supported by your ship, was there any one particular story that you seem to recall that was poignant and sort of was defining moment for the battleship when it was off the coast?
I think the defining point came from his story that he told me today, where his gang was surrounded and they were saved by that. I think the most interesting one, which was also the most tricky, was when the doctor, the head of the sort of the hospital, like in whatever that television series is, came out to the ship and said, "Would you consider firing a couple of rounds after midnight over the hospital because we're taking incoming?" I said, "You know, you're not supposed to do that." He said, "I understand you're willing to do a lot of things." I said, "Well, give me 12 hours to think it over and figure it out, and then, okay." So I said, "Okay, I'm going to send my doctor over to you. You send me one of your doctors, so I got a hostage in case something happens." And so, to make a long story short, we illegally fired over their operating room for approximately 30 days, and for 30 days they took no incoming. And I guess that's perhaps as rewarding as you can get, because you see that happening and you know that somebody's being able to be operated on without the... Those surgeons must have really been something to take incoming and do operations at the same time. And my doctor was a cardiovascular specialist, so they worked him so hard he said he never wanted to go back ashore again.
I can believe that. Skipper, bringing the ship back to Long Beach, California after their six-month deployment and getting ostensibly ready for another tour of duty and find out later on that the ship was going to be decommissioned, what was the reaction to the crew, your reaction at that time learning that news?
I think the most interesting part was that we were returning and all the wives were on the pier waiting for us for the next day, and I got this radio call from the mayor of Long Beach, and I'm talking to him on the radio when I'm interrupted by the messenger who comes in and hands me this top secret message saying classified information will follow immediately, reverse course, proceed maximum practical speed to return to off South Korea. And of course, the crew thought they were going home, and a lot of them were going to be discharged because President Johnson, I believe it was, had said that anybody that hits port who was a reserve can have their enlistment canceled and can get out of the Navy whenever they hit port. And I had bypassed Pearl Harbor. So, make a long story short, turned around, headed back, and as we got to the rendezvous point, Associated Press, who had joined us by that time, put out an article which made the crew's morale... You can imagine the morale was pretty low, having to be turned around when they expected to be going home for at least a couple of months. They wanted to come back, but they wanted to have a couple of months back home. And the